Right, thank you very much. And I'm Joan Roughgarden, and I'm a biologist, and I'm here to talk about the evolution of gender and sexuality. And the reason I'm doing this is that I attended my first gay pride parade in San Francisco about 12 years ago. And when I was there, I noticed a huge number of people, all of whom biology said were somehow defective. And I thought that maybe it's not the people that are defective, but it's biology that's defective. And that began an investigation into the extent of variation in gender and sexuality, which appeared in Evolution's Rainbow, the first of the two books that are on the screen here. Now, the issue from a biologist's point of view with the diversity in gender and sexuality is that it leads to challenges in what we teach in our ordinary curriculum. And this is a very unpleasant development. So the existence of gender and sexuality variation is problematic for biology, and as you know, it's also problematic in the political sector and the religious sector as well. Now, for biology specifically, the problem concerns an area of evolution called Darwin's sexual selection theory. And I'll tell you what that's about and then show you that it's pretty obviously incorrect. The first proposition that Darwin utters is that males of almost all animals have stronger passions than females. So we have the phrase passionate male tracing back to Darwin. And furthermore, he says that the female, with the rarest of exceptions, is less eager than the male. She is coy. So we have the phrase coy female. And in today's jargon, passionate male is replaced with promiscuous male and coy female with constrained female. And the third premise from Darwin is the most problematic. It pertains to characters like the peacock's tail and the antler on a deer. And it is that females, and so Darwin was asking, why does the peacock have the tail and does the deer have the antler? And his answer is that females choose mates who are more attractive, vigorous, and well-armed, just as man can give beauty to his male poultry. So he's envisioning that females are breeding males to have the traits that they have. Now why, you might ask, would females be choosing males with ornaments? The idea is that the females have expensive eggs, and the males, on the other hand, have cheap sperm. And so it's males are capable, in principle, of ranging far and wide and inseminating anything they come across. And females are necessarily obligated to defend their expensive investment in eggs. Therefore, the female is forced to be coy and choosy, and the male passionate or promiscuous. And this is the party line that's currently taught in biology curricula worldwide. It's a nice story, in a sense. At least it's a story. But the question is whether it's true. And let me show you some examples of diversity in gender and sexuality that make these propositions almost useless. And one thing I need to emphasize is that the two initial premises, the passionate male and the coy female, are asserted as empirical generalizations. So if you go outside and you pick up a random bird or a random butterfly or any organism at random, the male is supposed to be passionate and the female coy, with very, very rare exceptions. And it will be obvious that the exceptions are far from rare. The first issue is that the assignment into sex as male or female is neither stable nor exclusive. If you go diving on a coral reef, about a third of the species that you see there consist of individuals who are both sexes at the same time or at different times during their life. So in the case of these species right here, the individuals change from female to male. That's a kind of RAS. In the case of this species right here, they change from male to female. And as I say, 30% of the species, if you simply go snorkeling on a coral reef, you see this all around you. And it's just simply not true that the categories of males and females are stable or comprehensive. Now, another important issue is called sex role reversal by biologists. And this pertains to males who do all the parental care and females who have to hustle around and find a male who's interested in them. And popular examples of this are the seahorses. Now, in fish, the parental care is usually provided by the male. And in birds, it's about 50-50 male and female. And in mammals, it's usually initially by the female. But in fish, the style of parental care varies from species. And in many cases, the males will glue the eggs to their tummy. And that is true of, that's true of the species in the middle here, which is a pipefish. Now, the seahorses are related to pipefish in that they have a big skin flap on their tummy, and the females deposit eggs into the male's tummy so that the males become, in a sense, pregnant. So this is a male seahorse being receiving eggs from that female. And what happens in this situation is that you can get more females hanging around looking for males to receive their eggs. And in that situation, then the males are in the position to decide what female they want to allow to deposit eggs in their skin flap. So this is exactly the reverse of the Darwinian story that it's females who are choosing males. Here it's males who are choosing females. Now that shows that the size of the sperm or the egg can't be important or definitive in determining the sex role of the animal, because male seahorses make tiny sperm, but yet they are nonetheless the ones who wind up doing all the parental care. In many species, there are several genders of males. In this species called the rough, the one on the left has is a male with a black collar around it. The one at the top has a white collar, and the one on the far right is has no collar. Now, the black-collared males at the time of mating go into an area which is called a lek, which is basically a red light district of males. And when the females are foraging by themselves and they want some sex, they just go and fly over to the lek where all the black-collared males are hanging out, and then the males try to attract them into mating with them. But the plot thickens, because this white-collared male at the top hangs out with the females for a little while and gets to know them, and then he leaves those females before they approach the lek, and he goes to the lek where the black-collared males are, and the black-collared males court him and ask him to join them. So that when the females arrive, they find some territories with two colors, two styles of males, and the females prefer to mate with a pair of males of the two colors rather than with a male of one color by itself. And I conjecture that the reason for that is that the white-collared males get to know the females and can serve, so to speak, as marriage brokers. When the females fly into the black-collared males, they can make introductions and invite specific females to join them. In any case, the existence of multiple types of males also contradicts the Darwinian story in which all males are of one type and all females another. Then we get to the question of homosexuality. There's a lot of mating that takes place between animals of the same sex. And these are elephants right here. These are bighorn sheep from Montana. And these are primates, our closest relatives. And there's well over 300 species of vertebrates alone in which same-sex sexuality has been observed in nature. So this is quite common, and observed, I mean officially observed, and published in the primary literature. Now, These are gorillas on the left, which is a male-male interaction, and on the center and right, we have a female-female interaction between bonobos, and female bonobos will mate with one another several times during the day as a form of networking. So what's really going on here is that there's a lot of physical intimacy between animals, not only same-sex sexuality, but also multiple grooming, reciprocal preening. And all of these forms of behavior are ways of exchanging physical pleasure with one another. And I've suggested that the reason this evolves is as a mechanism to produce bonding and collaboration between individuals. And when individuals are physically intimate with one another, they're able to coordinate their activities and work toward a common goal because they experience mutual pleasure in achieving a common goal. So it's actually the realization of the common goal that is pleasurable in these intimate interactions. Now, in light of all of this, the whole idea of sexual selection looks almost absurd. It's incorrect, but it also is irrelevant. It doesn't even address the degree of diversity that occurs in nature. But the issue of collaboration brings us to the next issue, which is the one of family. And biologists, I believe, also have an incorrect account of family life. This is a quotation from Jeff Parker in the UK. The family is now perceived as a cauldron of conflict, with each of the players having different interests, sexual conflict, parent-offspring conflict, and sib conflict simultaneously. And this, too, is taught in the biology curricula. And if it were true, it paints a bleak picture of the aspirations that we all share here of building a better life founded on collaboration. But it may not be true. The idea of a biological family that I've been suggesting in the last year is summarized in this diagram, in which the parent-parent relationship is essentially collaborative. And the collaboration is realized through physical intimacy that produces cooperation, that resolves genetic conflict, because we can't avoid the fact that there is genetic conflict at the beginning, but it needs to get resolved. Now, with respect to the parent-offspring relationship, my suggestion is that there is, in effect, an auction of resources to offspring that produce an incentive to resolve the genetic conflict. And what I'm doing here is drawing on the economic theory of the firm from economics and viewing a family as though it were a firm or a company whose product is offspring, and asking whether or not the organization, the economic organization of a firm, could serve as a guide to understanding animal family life. And the specifics are that in the parent-offspring firm, the parent is in a position to give food to the offspring. And so what the parent does is it indicates the price of the food to the offspring, and the offspring pay for this by the quantity of begging that they carry out. And the offspring are able to communicate their demand curve to the parent. And if the parent knows the demand curve, it can set the price of food that it charges to the offspring so that the offspring honestly communicate their needs to the parent. And when that happens, the family functions as a very efficient unit for the production of offspring. And so, therefore, we get the formation of collaboration in two ways, either through collaboration, either through physical intimacy, which produces collaboration, or through the setting of incentives, and the circumstances differ. So I've been blessed in all my work by the help of these collaborators, Errol Ace, who's from Turkey, and Priya Iyer, who's from India. So thank you so much.